I think I was the only one that wasn't from Boyd County. I'm from Boyd County, and the rest of our gospel, like I said, mine was a little thing to make a big difference. So one thing that I looked at was I had mainly biology, and I had 10th grade students, and we looked at what do they want to do to make their class more interesting. So what we're going to look at is, you know, how do I make my class more hands-on with my students, looking at the cellular biology and the genetics, how to make it real life investigations, the CSI track things, make it more inquisitive for them. How can they see it, feel it, touch it type things, because they don't want just hands-on lectures anymore. Like my students, if I just go in and lecture every single day to them, then they're not going to pay attention to it and stuff. But they always bring in, like when we get to a topic, they're like, well, I saw this on TV, how can this be true? Explain how did they convict this person on TV, or, you know, explain why did this happen to them, or I read this on the news, or how can this person be this way, genetically. So we always look at, you know, how did they see this in the real world, and how did this happen? So it kind of brought me into how can I bring this into the real world without just lecturing to them every day. So that's how I got it. Little things make a big difference. Started from microscopes all the way through to crime scene investigations. So, my findings, what do you want in biology class? I asked my students when I was doing my grant, because I couldn't come up with what I really wanted to do for my grant. So I asked them, and they're like, I want all hands-on instruction. I don't want notes. I don't want to sit in the classroom every day. They want labs, activities, experiments. Because just because it's an experiment doesn't mean it has to be the chemicals. Because as soon as you ask them, they're like, well, I'm going to blow something up. And I was like, well, in biology, we're not going to be dealing with those kind of things. You wait until we get into chemistry for that. So I was like, what other kind of labs do you want to do? And they're like, well, I want to do something like what I see in CSI. So then I got into, well, what else do you want to do? So at the end of the year, we're going to get into dissections at the end. They also said they didn't want any bookwork. So this whole year, my kids have not opened the book hardly at all unless they were looking at a picture. And then finally, they wanted to make it fun. So the first thing we did is I got a new Elmo, as it's called, or document camera. And the thing that I was least excited about, that I was excited with at first, was that it had this microscope thing attached to it, to where I should be able to project it up on the screen. And it's not worked out the best, because the point was that I should be able to put the microscope slide out and project it on the screen, show the kids what it was, and then they go find it automatically, and then they can learn to look at it and learn there. And I can change my objective lens, and then they can find the same exact things. Well, it didn't come in time, that put it off, and then when it did come in, it's still not working the way I wanted it to. But we still did the whole rest of the thing, like I could work without it. Next, we went into the Genes in the Bottle lab, in which they took their own cheek cells and they saw that, yes, we talked about DNA, now I get to see my DNA. So they actually went through, they sprayed inside their cheeks and with different enzymes, and they learned how the enzymes work. They actually ended up going through and seeing their own DNA uncool, and the end product, which was the DNA, is that they got to keep a necklace with their DNA in it. And there's still some today that actually instead of being a necklace, they keep it on a bracelet or something like that they really enjoy. Like they actually get to see, hey, it's not just something you tell me, it's actually my DNA. So this actually shows the process of the students step by step. And they learned that what actually water bath is. They learned how enzymes can sit and how you have to sort different things in. Next, we actually went through and learn pipetting techniques. So I actually took them through and was like, okay, if you can't learn how to pipette, then you're not going to get the job of being the lab tech. Okay? So if you don't pipette correctly, the lab's not going to call you for the job next week. And stuff. So some of them, while I actually watched them pipette, I was like, okay, I wouldn't hold my breath for the lab to call me. Okay? Because the whole point was that it went faster. That if you don't pipette in, it's going to spill through, and then you're going to get CNAs. And your job's not going to run through. And thus, you're not going to get the job as the pipetter. So when we actually got to the gel electrophoresis part, which you see here, I had to make the gels myself. And then the students actually got to go through the process of the CSI crime scene. It actually came with a book that set up the crime for him. It was this guy, he went to the ATM, he got beat up, and he was actually killed. And he had four crimes, or four pieces of DNA. You had the suspect, two suspects, you had the victim, and then you had the guy had scratched the suspect or the actual murderer. So you had to see who was the actual murderer in there. So the people in the lab had to go through and see if they could convict. So it was all based on how well they popped it out. And we'd set up, and there was a video that showed them how to actually do it. So my results that I had was the students had a hands-on portion to see if they could convict the right person, because we took it from cells, how cells had DNA, and then how we had DNA in our cells to this actual crime scene. They had a lot of paper that gave me results, and then they're going to have their test, their EOC, on the 13th of May. Here's from the DNA, the genes in the bottle, how it showed their DNA, which you can actually see in their test tube into the necklace that they got to keep. And then we'll see here in a minute with the gel electrophoresis, the crime scene, that some of them actually got to convict the criminal because it shows up perfectly, which you can't see for the sun here. But there's two veins like this. They had to put it in correctly to show like this was the victim's DNA. This was suspect one. This was the actual evidence from the crime scene. And then this was suspect two. And if you could see it, suspect two, they would count out because there's two veins. But in this one, it lines up perfectly with the evidence. And there was a video that shows them that you have to put it that way so that you could be able to do that. So, and from this, the students, they would give me feedback like, I want to be a crime scene forensics because, you know, I want to learn more about it, just maybe what my career is. And when they wrote the paper, which I just turned in the other day, someone was like, well, I think the labs really helped me. Whereas others would be like, well, you know, I enjoyed the labs, but it wasn't until I did the labs that I actually understood how you could piece the two things together.
Did you say you ordered the CSI kit?
Yes.
Where did you get
that? From Carolina. So, and the only thing was, like, you know, I had $2,500 on my grants, the two grants together, and I had enough to where, you know, I had to put them in groups to where, you know, I only had 15 gels I could make, and I had six groups of kits. So we had to do them either on different days or put them in large enough groups to where, you know, some had to watch where others had to perform. That's the reason why I did it to where they had to do the test, and the ones who were the best at pipetting, they got the jobs to be the technicians.